Well, all right. Shalom, shalom to everyone out there. Shalom. Especially to the Most High's 1/3 hopeful elect out there. Shalom. Also, to all of the brethren and sisters out there that's spreading this biblical truth with all faith, truth, and sincerity. To all of our people out there with eyes to see, ears to hear, and a mind to understand during their spare time with all faith, truth, and sincerity. Shalom. All right. So let's get this started by giving all honor, thanks, praise, and glory to our Heavenly Father and His only begotten Son, which is the Most High, and His Son Christ, who this world and society foolishly and ignorantly deems Jesus. Secondly, this is your brother, Yahweh, Yasharah, from the sea souls of Israel, the rocks of offense, and also the ambassadors for righteousness and the restorers of paths and the repairers of the breach, once again, dropping you another video. So brothers and sisters, what this video is going to be about basically is part two to a video that I previously was doing concerning the whole speaking in tongues thing, right? To bring some truth and clarity to what speaking in tongues is according to the biblical scripture. And the reason why I'm doing this video is because unfortunately a lot of our people are stuck on this pseudo false doctrine that when you're speaking in tongues, you're speaking in an unknown tongue, an unrecognizable tongue to God, and you're jumping around like some lunatic all over the place, man. And that's totally unbiblical. There's nowhere in the scriptures that says that when you're speaking in tongues to God, you're speaking in a language that no one can recognize or understand, man. So that's the reason why I'm doing this video here, right? And also, like I was saying before in my first video, you know, when I gave my flyer to this couple that I ran into coming out of my local department store or whatever, right? And, you know, when his wife, I perceived that to be his wife, you know, that's the woman that he was with, right? Now, the Jake, you know, when I say Jake, that's like short for Jacob, right? The descendants of Jacob, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, and Seminole Indians of Negroid descent, right? So, as I was saying, and he sort of looked like he understood what speaking in tongues was, right? But unfortunately, the woman that he was with, it looked like she was still sort of a little bit stuck in the doctrine, the religious doctrine of what speaking in tongues is, right? So that's the reason why she asked me, you know, she was like, do people of your faith speak in tongues, or have they ever spoken in tongues before? And I replied to her, I said, well, that all depends on how you perceive speaking in tongues. Is it according to how you think it is? Or what you've been told, or is it according to the biblical scripture? Now, according to the biblical scripture, speaking in tongues is when you're uttering something that people can understand, or what people can interpret it when you're speaking to the Most High, right? So this is why the video is being done, to bring some enlightenment and truth to this matter, man. So just like I said before, this is not a video to bash or whatever. This is a video to enlighten spiritually and give the knowledge to our people according to the biblical scripture what speaking in tongues is, and also to that couple, right? Mainly his wife, you know what I'm saying, to give her the correct understanding of what speaking in tongues is according to the biblical scriptures, man, right? So as I was saying, you know, the last video that I left off, you know, I believe it was in the book of Ezekiel chapter 3, right? So we're going to kick this one off starting in the New Testament, you know, as most of you so-called Christians, religious Christians, believe that, you know, people of our faith, which is the same exact faith of you, like I said before, we're reading out of the same Bible, man, right? So as religious Christians love to believe that we only stick with the OT only, right? Although there are people in our faith that only stick to the OT, but I'm what you would call a messianic, right? I believe in Hamashiach. I believe in the Christ of Nazareth. I follow the whole entire Bible, right? According to truth, all right? Not according to what we're told by religious pastors or the Roman Catholic Church, man, right? So we're going to start in the book of St. Luke, chapter 1, which is the gospel, okay? And this time I'm going to bring it up on my screen so everyone can see and read along, just in case you got your Bible. Hopefully the couple that's looking at this video, if you're watching it, you know, just like I said, I was going to do a video concerning this, and you can check it out whenever you get the chance on my channel, right? So we're going to bring it up on the screen here. which is the book of St. Luke, chapter 1, right? Okay, so let me type it in right here. And also, this is going to be in reference to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 3, when it's written in there where when you're unable to speak, your tongue is going to cleave to the roof of your mouth, right? When you're not going to be able to give utterance to people so that they can understand you, especially when you're prophesying and praying to the Most High, right? So you can also link this to that, which is in the book of St. Luke, chapter 1, starting at verse 18, right? And just to give you a little clarity on what's being spoken about here, this is Zacharias, the Levite, when he was speaking to the angel Gabriel in the temple concerning the birth of John, right? The Baptist, okay? So as it says here, verse 18 from the top, and Zacharias said unto the angel, which is Gabriel, right? Whereby shall I know this? So he's speaking about how should I know that me and my wife Elizabeth is going to give birth to John, right? For I am an old man and my wife is well stricken in years. Meaning, like, if you want to relate this to today's time, you know, you can say that Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth, they was like in their 60s, I guess, you know, mid 60s, late 50s, right? Not to say that that's old. For all of the older people that may be watching my video, right, in the faith and outside of the faith, that's not to say that 60 and 50 is old, but, you know, concerning today's times, people will think that, you know, that's a little bit up in age to have kids, right? And this is what Zacharias is telling Gabriel. He's like, for I am an old man and my wife is well stricken in age, verse 19. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, which is the messenger, right, angel, that stand before the presence of God, which is the Most High power, and am sent to speak unto thee, which is you, right, Zacharias, and to shew thee these glad tidings, meaning good news. You know, he's an ambassador of heaven, which is of good news, right? Verse 20, and behold, thou shalt be dumb. Okay, so this, like I was saying before, a lot of our people, unfortunately, love to misuse the word dumb as it means stupid or foolish or ignorant, right? But this right here is going to tell you exactly what dumb means. This is like another reiteration to what I always say, right? And behold, thou shalt be dumb and not able to speak, okay? Until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. Okay, so that's the reason why the angel or the messenger Gabriel, the ambassador of heaven, told Zacharias that I'm going to make you dumb. You're not going to be able to speak because you don't even believe in me. You believe because you're old and your wife is old, right? Or considerably old, right? Let me reiterate that you can't have a child. But I'm here to tell you that you're going to birth a son and his name is going to be John, right? So being that Zacharias didn't believe that, the angel Gabriel made him dumb, meaning not able to speak, right? As it says here again in verse 20 from the middle, until that day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season, verse 21. And the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. Okay, so there was people that followed Zacharias to the temple because they wanted to go there and pray too, because Zacharias, being that he was a Levite, according to the old custom, he had to go to the temple and burn incense so that the people could give their prayers and supplications up to the Most High. Now, this right here was before Hamashiach. So now we pray through Hamashiach to the Most High, and we also can use, you know, the association with incense too, because that's a sweet and savory smell and scent to the Most High, right? That gives you the protection of the angels according to the old customs, right? So this, like I was saying before, this was before Hamashiach was born. So that was Zacharias' lot. That was his obligation to the temple, that he had to go there and bring the incense for the people, right? So that's the reason why it says it is here in verse 21. And the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. Verse 22. And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless, meaning that his tongue was cleaved to the roof of his mouth. Just like it says in the book of Ezekiel chapter 3, that you're not going to be able to speak because you're going to be made dumb and your tongue is going to cleave to the roof of your mouth, right? So let's jump down to verse 59 to bring clarity to what I'm trying to bring out here, right? And it reads, and it came to pass that on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child. Okay, so, you know, to sort of speed forward, this is to let you know that, you know, Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth, they actually gave birth to John. All right, you know, something that Zacharias didn't believe because, you know, he felt that he was too old and his wife was too old. But it came to pass, as Gabriel said, that you're going to give birth to a son, right? So as it says here, verse 59, again from the top, and it came to pass that on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias after the name of his father, which is his dad, which is Zacharias the Levite, right? Verse 60, and his mother answered and said, not so, but he shall be called John, all right? So this is what was told to Elizabeth when she gave birth to her son. She's going to name him John, right? And they said unto her, there is none of thy kindred, which is your family members, right? That could be your brothers, your cousins, the male cousins of your family, your uncles or whatever, your dad, your granddad, right? And they said unto her, there is none of thy kindred that is called by this name. Verse 62. And they made signs to his father how he would have called him, all right, or have him called. Okay, so right here, you know, just like I always say, you know, in some of my videos, that the scriptures have everything in it that can relate to today's times and today's happenings, right? Or what's going on in today's times, right? So right here, this is your sign language, right? You know, this is people using paper or cardboard boxes or whatever they can write on to communicate with people if it wasn't through sign language, right? So as it says here, verse 63, and he asked for a writing table and wrote saying, his name is John, and they marveled all, okay? So being that he couldn't speak verbally because Gabriel, the angel, he still had him dumb, right? So he wrote down on that piece of paper or whatever, or that writing table, that his name is going to be John. This is what Gabriel told me to name our son, our blessing, right? Verse 64. And his mouth was opened immediately and his tongue loosed. And he spake and praised God, okay? Praise God when you're giving honor to God, when you're praising the Most High, right? Verse 65. And fear came on all that dwelt round about them, and all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea, okay, which is in Jerusalem, right? Verse 66. And all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, which is their minds, according to the definition and the etymology of the word, right? Saying, what manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Most High was with him. Verse 67, which is my point, right? And his father, Zacharias, was filled with the what? The Holy Ghost, right? Which is also the Holy Spirit. And prophesied, saying, okay, so right there, that's a clear cut to what these so-called religious churchgoers believe, that when you're speaking in tongues, you're speaking in an unknown, unrecognizable tongue, and you're jumping around like some lunatic all over the place, right? But what it says here in verse 67, and his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which is the Most High power of Yasharal, right? For he hath visited and redeemed his people. Verse 69, and he raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, meaning King David, right? Verse 70, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, all right? So this also to let you know that the Most High, when he speak his truth, okay? When he's speaking from the heavens, he speak through the holy prophets, okay? Who's the holy prophets? Those are the ones that's speaking this word, man. As it's written in the book of Acts, you know, the spirits are subjugated to all of the people who they are before, who they were before the regeneration, right? So if you were a prophet in your previous life, then you're going to be a prophet in this life, okay? If you were a sinner in your previous life, then more than likely you're going to be a sinner in this life, lest you repent, right? If you were a mighty man in your previous life, then in this life, during the generation, you're going to be a mighty man in this life. But the whole point is to be a mighty man for the Most High Man, doing his will, not the world's will, right? Which is joining their military, okay? As it says here, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began. So even when he created this world, man, with Christ, which is Hamashiach of Nazareth, right? This was all ordained from the beginning, man, that the Most High is not going to speak himself. You know, he's going to shoot his secret onto the prophets as it's written. Okay, so when the Most High speaks, he gives the message to the true men of the Lord, man, which is of him, the ones who's speaking these scriptures, man, right? The ones who's making these videos as I am, letting you know that when you're speaking in tongues, it's not because you're speaking in an unknown tongue and jumping around like some fool, okay? Like a chicken with their head cut off, all right? That's not biblical, man, right? As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, okay, which have been since the world began, okay? All right, so let's go to the book of Colossians, chapter 4. Okay, so here we go. We're in the book of Colossians, chapter 4. And I'm going to start at verse 2, and it reads, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving, meaning that, you know, we supposed to always pray and also watch what's going on in the world with thanksgiving. You know, meaning that if the Most High is preserving you from all of the calamities and all of the atrocities and troubles that's going on in the world, you know, be thankful that the Most High is not allowing stuff like that to happen to you, right? So as it says here again in verse 2, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Verse 3, withal praying also for us, that the Most High power would open onto us a door of what? Utterance, okay? Utterance to speak the mystery of Hamashiach, for which I am also in bonds. Verse 4, that I may take or make it manifest as I ought to speak, okay? Make it manifest as I ought to speak, all right? So that's letting you know right there. If you're praying or prophesying, or as it's written here, to speak the mystery of Christ, which is Hamashiach, you're going to have a door of utterance, okay? Meaning, you know, something that you're going to be saying is going to be understood by the people that's around you, all right? They're going to perceive what you're saying, okay? That the Most High would open onto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds, meaning that he is also a servant of Hamashiach. He's a follower of Hamashiach, a believer of Christ, okay? that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Okay. Verse 5. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Okay. For those who are without the knowledge of the scriptures, without knowledge of who they are according to the biblical scripture, right? Without knowledge of who their one and only true power is, who's their God, all right? So that's those that are without, all right? Verse 6, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Okay, so if you're answering someone, that means that you're having a communication. In order for you to have a communication with someone, they have to understand what you're saying. They have to understand what you're uttering out, okay, what you're speaking, okay? So that's the reason why it's written here in verse 3, that the Most High power will open unto us a door of utterance unto us, all right, to speak the mystery of Hamashiach, okay? So to bring a little bit clarity to that, let's look up the definition of what utterance is. Okay, it actually came right up, right? So as you can see here.
Utterance,
a spoken word, all right? Statement or vocal sound, all right? In a sentence, he whispered as if to lend his utterance and added confidentiality, okay? And then you have for your similitudes, remark, comment, word, expression, okay? Statement, observation, declaration, pronouncement, reflection, thought, opinion, okay? So how can you have all of these right here if you're uttering something to the Most High in an unknown tongue and no one knows what the hell you're speaking about? They don't even know what you're talking about. They don't even know if you're speaking to the Most High, all right? You could be speaking to some false idol for all they know, right? So this is what utterance means, man, when you're speaking through the Holy Spirit, all right? Not when you're speaking a whole bunch of gibberish and jumping around all over the place, right? A spoken word, okay? Statement or vocal sound, all right? And then you have your secondary definition. It says the action of saying or expressing something aloud, all right? Voicing, saying, speaking, expression, delivery, sounding, mouthing, breathing, okay? So you have all of these right here, man. Articulation, right? And then it says here, in linguistics, it says an uninterpreted chain of spoken or written language, okay? Now that's in linguistics, all right? That's not talking about the true definition of the word utterance, all right? And then you have here, what is an example of an utterance? To utter means to say, okay? To communicate, all right? So when you're saying something, you're making utterances, all right? Saying 24 in a math class is an utterance, okay? Saying 24, all right? Which is a part of the Latin English language, okay? Something that people who speaks English also can understand, right? So just to give you a little understanding and definition of what the word utterance means. So when you're reading this scripture here, as it says in the book of Colossians 4, okay, verse 3 again from the top, with all praying also for us that the Most High power will open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Hamashiach, for which I am also in bonds, meaning that we're also followers of Hamashiach as well, right? Let's go to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. Okay, slack here. That's not what I wanted there. Okay, here we go. The King James Bible, baby. All right, Ephesians 6. And we're going to go down to verse 17. Right? And it reads, "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit," which is the Holy Spirit, right? "Which is the word of the Most High power." Okay, so that's our sword, man. You know, so as servants and true believers of the Most High and followers of His law, statutes, and commandments, we always supposed to have His truth meditated in our minds, right? And also the scriptures. Okay. Verse 18. "Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Spirit," but Spirit written here, right? "And watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints," or perseverance, Salakia. Verse 19. "And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel." Okay, so if you're going to make known the mystery of the gospel by giving utterance through the Holy Spirit, as it says here, "praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit," okay, which is the Holy Spirit. And then it says right here in verse 19, "and for me, that utterance may be given unto me," okay, through the Holy Spirit from the Most High, "that I may open my mouth boldly," as I'm doing right now in this video, right, "to make known the mystery of the gospel." Verse 20. "For which I am an ambassador in bonds," okay, and which is the ambassadors for Christ, all right, and which is the name of the group, all right, "for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak," meaning in a language that people can understand and interpret it, okay. Moving along, let's go to the book of Job, chapter 33. So some of these scriptures, you don't even really have to break down like that, man. You could just read the scriptures as our people should do if they want the correct understanding, instead of, you know, following suit on what they're told from their religious pastor, man, right? Or what they've learned through religion, so-called religion, right? But your religion is just your belief. It's your faith, okay? So, you know, the word religion isn't subjugated only to so-called Christianity or the Roman Catholic Church or Islam, right? So in the book of Job, chapter 33, as a matter of fact, I'm going to start at verse 1, right? And it reads, "Wherefore, Job, I pray thee, hear my what speeches," okay, "and hearken to all my words." Verse 2. "Behold, now I have opened my mouth, my tongue have spoken in my mouth." Verse 3. "My words shall be of the uprightness of my heart," which is my mind, "and my lips shall utter knowledge." Okay, utter knowledge clearly. All right. How he's doing this? From the Most High, man, right? From the Holy Spirit, okay? So you're going to utter knowledge clearly, okay? Not in an unknown, unrecognizable, uninterpreted tongue, man, right? Verse 4. "The Spirit," which is the Holy Spirit of the Most High power, "have made me, and the breath of the Almighty have given me life," okay? The breath is the Holy Spirit, the truth, the knowledge, and the water, and the wisdom of the scriptures, man, which is the breath of the Almighty have given me life, man. Okay. Let's go to chapter 8. Still in the book of Job. All right. So all of these right here, man, it's plain, you know. You don't even really have to break some of these scriptures down, man. It's written plainly on what should be understood, right? So once again, we're in the book of Job, chapter 8. And we're going to go down to verse 8, where we're going to start. And it reads, "For inquire, I pray thee, of the former age, and prepare thyself to the search of their fathers." Verse 9 in parentheses, right? "For we are but of yesterday, and know nothing, because our days upon the earth are a shadow." Verse 10. "Shall not they teach thee, and tell thee, and utter words out of their heart," which is their mind. Verse 11. "Can the rush grow up without mire? Can the flag grow without water?" Verse 12. "Whilst it is yet in his greenness, and not cut down, it wherewith before any other herb." Verse 13. "So are the paths of all that forget the Most High." Okay, so that's what he's talking about there. You know, that's how the people that forget the Most High, the ones who cast the law, statutes, the commandments behind them and say that the laws are done away with. You know, we're in for everlasting grace. We can do whatever we want. We can eat whatever we want, and we can live however we want. We can live alternative lifestyles. We can be in spiritual fornication and adultery, okay? Worshiping Allah and Muhammad in Islam, Krishna, Shiva, Madhava in Hinduism, Buddha in Buddhism, Virgin Hail Mary in Roman Catholicism, okay? The image of the beast in religious Christianity, your secret societies, okay? Your fraternities and sororities, your witchcraft, okay? Your African spirituality, worshiping your ancestors and angels, okay? So this is what the Most High says about you, man. "Can the rush grow up without mire? Can the flag grow without water?" Okay, which is really the word, the truth of these scriptures, man, right? "Whilst it is yet in his greenness, and not cut down, it wherewith before any other herb." Okay, verse 13. "So are the path of all that forget the Most High power, and the what the hypocrites hope shall perish." Okay, verse 14. "Whose hope shall be cut off, and whose trust shall be a spider's web." Okay, so if you're going around talking about, you're speaking to the Most High in an unknown tongue that no one can recognize or interpret it or understand, then you're being a hypocrite, okay? Because all throughout the scriptures so far that I've brung out, it says if you're speaking through the Holy Spirit of the Most High, you're going to utter words of understanding and knowledge, okay? A language that people can understand, all right? And if you're not doing that, then you're being a hypocrite, as it says here in verse 13. "So are the paths of all that forget the Most High power." Okay, so if you're not pushing this truth of this word, man, of these scriptures, man, if you're not going around telling people that, you know, if you're speaking to God, if you're prophesying to God and the people through the Holy Spirit, you're going to say things that's understandable, okay? You're going to speak the truth of these scriptures here, man, like I'm doing right now. As a matter of fact, this is a prime example. This is speaking in tongues, you know. This is an example of it. I'm speaking the truth of these scriptures, man. I'm uttering knowledge through the Holy Spirit of the scriptures to y'all through this video, man, okay? That's what speaking in tongues literally is, man, literally, okay? Verse 13 again from the top. "So are the paths of all that forget the Most High power, and the hypocrite's hope shall perish." Okay, let's go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 4. And once again, this is your brother, I have what I Yashara, for the seed souls of Israel, the rocks of offense, and also the ambassadors for righteousness, the restorers of paths and the repairers of the breach. Once again, dropping you another video. So once again, we're going to go to the book of 1 Peter, chapter 4. And we're going to go to verse 10. And it reads, "As every man have received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of the Most High power." Verse 11. if any man speak, okay, or utter or have an utterance, right? If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of the Most High Power, okay? What's the oracles of the Most High Power? These scriptures, man, the truth, right? If any man minister, okay, in which I'm doing right now, right? Let him do it as of the ability which the Most High Power giveth, okay, through his Holy Spirit, right? That the Most High in all things may be glorified through Hamashiach. To whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So it be, right? So that's pretty much plain, man. Don't have to break that down, right? Let's go to the book of Sirach, chapter 15. So the people who think that when you're speaking in tongues, man, you're jumping around like some fool lunatic and speaking in an unknown language, man. You're going to get the true understanding from this video today, man. What is considered speaking in tongues according to the biblical scripture, right? Okay, so here we go in the book of Sirach, which is also known as Ecclesiasticus, which is in the book of Apocrypha, which is the hidden books of the Holy Scriptures, right? In the book of Ecclesiasticus, which is also known as Sirach, chapter 15, and we're going to start at verse 1, and it reads, he that feareth the Most High will do good, and he that hath the knowledge of the law shall obtain her, okay? What is the her? That's the wisdom, okay? And that's only going to be obtained by knowing and doing the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High, as it says here, man. Verse 1 from the middle. And he that hath the knowledge of the law, okay, shall obtain her. Verse 2. And as a mother shall she meet him and receive him as a wife married of a virgin, okay? Verse 3. With the bread of understanding, okay, the bread is the word, okay? Also, the bread can be known as Hamashiach. That can be used interchangeably, right? With the bread of understanding shall she feed him and give him the water of wisdom to drink, okay? So that's letting you know what's being explained in verse 1. You know what the water is, right? Verse 4. He shall be stayed upon her and shall not be moved. Meaning that we're always going to stay on the knowledge and wisdom and the law, statutes, the commandments of these scriptures, man, right? And shall rely on her, which is the wisdom, and shall not be confounded. Meaning if we always continue in doing the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High, we're never going to be confounded, man. You can't go wrong trusting in the Most High and his son Hamashiach, right? Verse 5. She shall exalt him above his neighbors, okay? Literally, okay? Meaning all of the brothers and sisters that's around you that's not in this faith, that's not in this truth, there's going to be a distinctive distance and a difference between you, man. All right? The people is going to recognize that if you're letting your light shine, if you're rehearsing the righteous acts, okay? If you're wearing your fringes, okay? People are going to know that you're special, you're about something. Okay, you're keeping the laws of the Most High. They're going to know that and they're going to see that. All right. And that's an example. Now, if you're not wearing your fringes and then you're mixing and mingling amongst the crowd, they're not going to tell you any different than anyone else because no one else there is wearing fringes, neither are you. But, you know, you claim to know the law and you claim to be the light, but no one can tell unless you open your mouth. But they're not going to tell initially because they don't see anything special with you. Right. Because you're not wearing your fringes. Okay, so that's why it says this in verse 5, she shall exalt him above his neighbors, okay, and in the midst of the congregation shall she open his mouth, okay, which is the wisdom, meaning if you're in the Holy Spirit, you're going to be given the wisdom of the scriptures, and then you're going to open your mouth according to what's written, according to the oracles of the Most High, man, right? Verse 6, He shall find joy and a crown of gladness, and she shall cause him to inherit an everlasting name, meaning people want to remember you, man. When you're gone, they're going to know who you are wherever you go because you're letting your light shine, right? Verse 7, but foolish men shall not attain to her, and sinners, okay, was sin, the transgression of the Most High's laws, statutes, and commandments, man. It's not just being a bad person, using vulgar language, and going around starting a bunch of trouble, right? Being a lawbreaker or whatever, okay? When you're in sin, you're breaking the laws of the Most High, even though that runs hand in hand, but sin officially is defined as breaking the law, statutes, and commandments, according to the biblical scripture, right? But foolish men shall not obtain her, and sinners shall not see her. Verse 8, for she is far from pride, and men that are what? Liars cannot remember her. Okay, so you're a liar, man. If you're not keeping the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High, you don't have the knowledge and the wisdom of the scriptures, and you're going around telling people when you're speaking in tongues, you're speaking in an unknowing language, an uninterpreted language, man, right? And when you're dancing around like some fool or some lunatic or some crazy person, you have the Holy Spirit, right? That's being a liar, man. What this says right here, man. For she is far from pride, and men that are liars cannot remember her, okay? Which is the truth, all right? Let's go to the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1. Okay, so in the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, Salakia. And we're going to go down to verse 20. And it reads, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, meaning if you're going to be uttering truth, if you're going to be praying and prophesying to the Most High, you're not going to be doing it in an unknown, uninterpreted tongue, man, okay? An unrecognizable tongue, right? Someone's going to be able to have to interpret it, what you're saying, okay? Even if it's in another language, right? If you're in a country that's predominantly English spoken or whatever, and you're speaking in Spanish, then you're going to have somebody around you that speaks Spanish. Or if it's French, then you're going to have to have somebody around you that speaks French. Or if it's Arabic or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Any other African country language or whatever, or Russian or Ukrainian or Asian, right? Which is Japanese or Taiwanese or South Korean, Vietnamese, all right? If you have all of these different languages, you're going to have someone around you if you're speaking to the Most High, the God of the Bible, the God of Israel, okay? You're going to have an interpreter around you that's going to let the people know what you're saying, okay? It's not some unknown extraterrestrial language out of this world that no one knows about, right? So this is why it says this, man. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. Verse 21, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men, set apart men, okay, the ones who's keeping the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High, the ones who the Most High shews the secrets through, okay, but holy men of the Most High spake as they were moved by the what? The Holy Spirit. But the point is, they spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, man, okay? Spake, meaning that when they spoke, people understood, okay? So in continuation, let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 22. Okay, so we're in the book of Acts, chapter 22. And I'm going to start at verse 1. And it read, "Men, brethren, and fathers, hear ye my defense, which I make now unto you." Verse 2 in parentheses, right? "And when they heard that he spake in the Hebrew tongue," okay, "to them, they kept the more silence. And he said, I am verily a man which am a Jew." Okay, so just to let you know, this is Peter, right? You know, he's talking to the congregation, okay? And he's letting the people know that I am a Jew. I am a Hebrew Israelite, right? "I am verily a man which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law, the fathers, and was zealous towards the Most High power, as ye are this day." All right. So he taught according to the law, the perfect manner of the law, man. All right. And as it says here in parentheses, to give you a further understanding of what was said, he said, "And when they heard that he spake in the Hebrew tongue," okay, meaning, you know, even if it wasn't Latin or Greek or English or whatever, it was still someone around that understood what he was saying. He was speaking in the Hebrew tongue, man, right? "They kept the more silence, and he said, I am verily a man which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous towards the Most High power, as ye all are this day." Okay. So let's go to verse 12 in chapter 26, still in the book of Acts. All right. Just to add on to this right here. So that's giving you an example of what, no matter the language that you're speaking, it still have to be in a language that people understand, man. Okay. So we're in Acts chapter 26. We're going to jump down to verse 12. And it read, "Whereupon, as I went to Damascus," okay, Damascus is in the northern kingdom of Israel, right? "With authority and commission from the chief priests," verse 13, "at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them which journeyed with me." Verse 14, "And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the what? The Hebrew tongue." Okay, just like Peter. All right. Now this is the Most High. Okay. "Speaking in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" All right. "Is it hard for thee to kick against the pricks?" All right. Now in this sense right here, you know, Hamashiach, you know, he was speaking in Aramaic. He was speaking in the Hebrew tongue. Okay, so it's not some language that no one knows about, right? And then, of course, you know, Hamashiach, he had the Holy Spirit. He had the anointed spirit, okay? So if he always had the anointed spirit, he spoke in the Hebrew tongue, the Hebrew people understood him. He didn't speak in some unknown tongue, right? As it also says in the Gospels, you know, he haven't said anything in secret. Okay, so Hamashiach, he didn't speak in some unknown tongue. And as it says here, right? "And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." Verse 15. "And I said, Who art thou, Lord?" Okay, which is my ruler. Okay. "And he said, I am Hamashiach, whom thou persecutest. Okay, so at one time in his life, you know, Paul, he was a non-believer according to the biblical scripture. And he pretty much went against men of the Most High who taught the truth of the Most High and who kept the law, statutes, and commandments. You know, he totally just went against our whole faith and belief, man. Like basically some guys do today. You know, if they don't believe in the Bible, you know, if they're into so-called Egyptology, or if they're into Islam, or if they're into religious churchianity, or some secret society, or fraternity, or Buddhism, or Hinduism, or African spirituality, Pan-Africanism, right? If they're into all of these other false ideologies and dogmas, then they're basically was like Paul, how he was in his heyday, right? They totally just go against the Bible, go against scriptures, go against truth, go against the men who's keeping the law, statutes, and commandments, right? So basically, that's like your examples of how Paul used to be, right? And this is why Hamashiach says this in verse 15. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Hamashiach, whom thou persecutest, right? In the Hebrew tongue, okay? Also meaning that Paul understood the Hebrew tongue, okay? Because Paul himself was an Israelite. He was a Benjamite, right? So in continuation, let's go to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Okay, so here we go in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 12. And we're going to start at verse 1. And it reads, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Okay, verse 2. Ye know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. All right. Verse 3. Wherefore, I give you an understand to understand, Salakia, that no man speaking by the Spirit of the Most High calleth Hamashiach accursed, and that no man can say that Hamashiach is the Lord, which is the ruler over us. That doesn't mean the Most High, man. That means ruler over us, right? But by the Holy Spirit. Okay, so only if you operating through the Holy Spirit of the Most High, that's when you can confess Hamashiach. Okay, verse 4. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, meaning that we all going to have gifts. We all going to have our special gift, the way that we bring this word out. But it's going to be of the same Holy Spirit, right? Which is geared towards serving the Most High and following Hamashiach, right? Verse 5. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord, which is Hamashiach, right? Verse 6. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God, which is the same power, okay, the Most High power, which worketh in us all in all right, which is through his Holy Spirit, right? Verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, is given to every man to profit withal. Okay, so that means everyone have a chance to operate through Hamashiach's Spirit, all right? You know, it's not given to only one person, and then that person have to give it down to you, and then you speak according to their word or their interpretation or their understanding of things. The Most High give his Spirit to everyone, you know, for those who's sincerely seeking him and keeping his ways, man, right? Verse 7 again. But the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is giving to every man to profit withal. Verse 8. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit. Okay. Verse 9. To another, faith by the same Spirit, and to another, the gifts of healing by the what? The same Holy Spirit. Okay, so everyone have a opportunity or obligated to have the Holy Spirit of the Most High if they're sincerely seeking them, man. Okay? And this is what you call operating through the Holy Spirit. You know, it's not jumping around and acting a darn fool, saying that you have the Holy Spirit. You in there doing backflips, falling all over the self, falling all over your head, you know, you falling all over the pews in the church, you know, you going around hitting people, kicking people, talking about you in the Holy Spirit, speaking in unknown tongues, speaking a whole bunch of BS and gibberish, right? That's not operating through the Holy Spirit, man. As it says right here, let's go a few scriptures up once again. Verse 8. For to one is given the Spirit, given by the Spirit, the word of wisdom, okay, which is these scriptures here. To another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, okay. So this is how you operate in the Holy Spirit, man, right? To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. Verse 10, to another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy, meaning that they're going to actually be able to see what's going to happen, man. What's going to be coming down the pipeline in the future, especially for our people, man, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, the Seminole Indians of Negroid descent, man, right? To another, discerning of spirits, meaning that they're going to be able to recognize who's phony and who's real, okay? They're going to have that spirit of discernment, you know, to recognize the spirit of truth and error. Okay, to see who's in it only for the money and the fortune and the fame, all right, or if they're really in it to give you the truth and to get you to repent and turn back to the Most High, man, and keep the law, statute, and commandments, all right. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, diverse kinds of tongues, meaning that they're going to be multilingual, okay, but they're going to be speaking in tongues that people can understand, okay. As it says here, to another, the interpretation of tongues. Okay, so that goes hand in hand. All right, so if you're prophesying in a foreign language, you know, not an extraterrestrial language, all right, you're going to have an interpreter around you that's going to be able to interpret it, what you're saying, and give to the people that's listening to you the message of what you're trying to portray, right? Verse 11. But all these worketh that one and the same selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will, as the Most High will through his Spirit. Okay, so this is how everyone work together within a camp. Okay, you can't be by yourself. All right, now if you ask the Most High, he can give you all of these things. You know what I'm saying? But it's best to operate with brothers and sisters of understanding, man. Okay, to keep you on that straight and narrow path if you feel yourself falling off. Okay, so this is the reason why it's talking about the gifts that's given to multiple people, not just one person. Okay, and that also goes for like people who's the head of camps. Okay, all of the knowledge and all of the talents is not only given to you, it's also given to other people within your camp. Okay, they might have an understanding that's given from the Most High that could be better than yours, and they can break it down better than you, and they can interpret it better than you. All right, but if you want to be a controlling type of person and tell them that they can't teach what the Most High divinely gave them, but teach according to how you interpreted things, then you're not being a good leader, man. Okay, so you know, if someone's given a divine message by the Most High and they need to bring it out, you know, they need to shew it to the world, then you shouldn't stop them from doing it, man. If it's according to truth and according to the biblical scriptures, you should let them go ahead and do that, man, because the Most High divinely gave that to that person, man. Okay, if you're going to stop them, then you're dulling their light, you're stealing the oil, man, right? So this is the reason why it says this here, man. Verse 11 again from the top. But all these worketh that one and the self same Holy Spirit, dividing to every man. Okay. It didn't say dividing to one man. All right. Several as he will. Okay. Let's go to chapter 14, still in the book of 1 Corinthians. Okay, so here we go. We're in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 14, and I'm going to start at verse 6, and it reads, "Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, okay, what shall I profit you except I speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine?" Okay, meaning he's going to be speaking in a tongue that people can understand, right? Verse 7, "And even things without life, given sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds," okay, meaning that's how you're going to recognize the difference of the instruments by the way they sound, right? "How shall it be unknown what is piped or harped?" Okay, so if you're speaking in an unknown tongue that no one can understand, then how would people know what you're saying? How can they interpret that, right? Verse 7 again from the top. "And even things without life, given sound, whether pipe or harp," meaning, you know, that you have to use these things. These are things that have to be controlled by man. They don't make sounds on their own, right? "Except they give a distinction in the sounds. How shall it be known what is piped or harp?" Verse 8. "For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound," okay, "who shall prepare himself to the battle?" Verse 9. "So likewise ye, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken?" Okay. See, Paul breaks all of this down, man. So I don't understand. Like, especially for you so-called religious church-going Christians, right? Supposedly followers of Christ. How can you say, like, how can you fix your mind and your lips to say that you're speaking in tongues to the Most High and prophesying to the Most High, and no one knows what the hell you're saying, man, right? And it clearly states it here in the New Testament, in which you guys claim to follow. This is what Paul says here, man, right? Verse 8, "For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle?" Verse 9, "So likewise ye, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air." So that's all you're doing. You're speaking into the air. You're speaking a whole bunch of gibberish, right? You're not even speaking to God. God is not even listening to you, especially if you're not keeping his laws, statutes, commandments, man, right? So the Most High don't even hear you, man. But you want to say, oh, you're praying to the Most High through an unknown tongue and doing some weirdo dance that no one ever even seen before, but you're doing some sort of a holy dance, right? So this just goes to show how hypocritical some of these so-called religious churchgoers are, man, right? Let's jump down to verse 13. "Wherefore, let him that speak in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret it." Okay, verse 14. "For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful." So it's going to be unfruitful to the people, man. We don't even know what the hell you're talking about, right? Verse 15. "What is it then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also." Meaning that if you're going to pray in the Holy Spirit, You're going to pray with understanding, meaning that the people are going to understand what you're saying. And if you're going to sing, people want to know what you're singing because they know the language that you're speaking, right? Verse 16. Else, when thou shalt bless with the Holy Spirit, how shall he that occupieth the room of the unlearned say amen, meaning so it be, or we agree, right? At thy giving of thanks, seeing he understandeth not what thou sayest. Okay, right? Paul is clear, man, right? Verse 17, for thou verily givest thanks well, but other is not edified. So no one's edified if you're speaking in an unknown tongue, talking about you talking to God, man, right? Verse 18, I think my power, I speak with tongues more than ye all, meaning that he was multilingual, right? It doesn't mean that he was speaking in an unknown tongue that no one understood. That means he had multiple language that he knew to speak in, right? Because, you know, Paul, he dwelt amongst, you know, the Greco-Romans, right? And the Northern Kingdom Israelites, you know, around the Babylonian people, you know, the Hamites, the Canaanites, the Cushites, you know, he dwelt amongst all of them, man. Because just like I said, in Paul's heyday, he was against the truth, right? He was against the scriptures, man. He was against the people of the Most High, right? So he dwelt amongst other nations, man, right? Just as John, you know, he grew up in the deserts, you know, around the Arabic people, the Arabs, the Canaanites. And also, you know, the Assyrians, which is, you know, the East, the Edomites, the Canaanites, and the Ishmaelites all mixed in together, right? So that's the reason why Paul, you know, he had multiple tongues, man, as it says here. I thank my God, which is my power, I speak with tongues more than ye all, right? Verse 19. Yet in the church, I had rather speak five words of my understanding, that by my voice I might teach others also, okay, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. Man, that's plain. I don't even have to break that down, right? Verse 20. Brethren, be not children in understanding, howbeit in malice be ye children, but in understanding be men, okay? Be a man, man. If you're in understanding, right? Verse 21. In the law, it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips, I will speak unto this people. And yet for all that they will, they not hear me, saith the Most High. Okay, verse 22. Wherefore, tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not, okay? But prophesying serveth not for them that believe not, but for them which believe, okay? So that's what the prophesying serve for us, the true believers. We understand what's going on in the world. We understand the truth of the scriptures, the wisdom and the water of the scriptures, right? So the tongues are for a sign for them that believe, but to them that believe not, okay? So those, that's what the interpretation, the understanding of the scriptures is for those who believe not, meaning that he's going to be preaching and ministering to people that he wants to repent and come back to keeping the ways of the Most High, right? So that's what the tongues are. You know, the language of understanding is for the people that don't believe to make them believers, okay? And then he says right here, but prophesying service not for them that believe not, but for them which believe, meaning that, you know, we understand the meat of the scriptures. You know, we're past the milk. You know what I'm saying? So we're going to understand what's being prophesied, meaning what's going to come down the pipeline in the future for our people, because we understand the scriptures, man. But for those who don't believe, who's not even on the milk yet, they're not even going to understand the prophesying. Right. So that's the reason why most of our people, when you're trying to tell them something about what's going to come down the pipeline in the future for our people, they're looking at you like you got three heads, because they don't understand. Even if you're posting it on social media, they're not going to understand, or they're just going to just breeze right by it because they don't have that understanding. Right. Verse 23. If therefore the whole church be come together in one place, and all speak with tongues, And there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that ye are mad, meaning me or crazy, right? Because they're not going to understand what you're saying. Like if you're speaking in an unknown tongue. So they're going to say that you're crazy, man. Basically, this is what I'm saying to the people who claim that they're speaking in an unknown extraterrestrial tongue when they're speaking to the Most High. I'm going to say you're crazy. You're mad, right? Verse 24. But if all prophesy, and there come in one that believeth not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all. Okay, verse 25. And thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest, and so falling down on his face, he will worship the Most High Power, and report that the Most High Power is in you of a truth. Okay, so for those who don't understand the truth of what speaking in tongues is, he think that you're really talking to the Most High in your unknown tongue. So he's going to think, oh, wow, this person is a godly person, right? They're jumping all around. You know, they all in and out of the pews. They all up there by the podium. You know, they jumping around, hitting people and all that. Oh, this must be a holy man, right? He got the Holy Spirit, but this person don't even understand what the hell is going on because he's an unbeliever or he just coming into the faith, right? So this is what Paul is saying here, man, right? Verse 24, but if all prophesy and there come in one that believeth not, okay, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, okay, of all of those people. He is judged of all, okay? Verse 25, and thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest, and so falling down on his face, he will worship the Most High and report that the Most High is in you of a truth. Okay, and that also goes for if you're speaking in a language that he can understand and he knows that you're referencing the Most High, then he's going to recognize that, you know, you're a person of God and of truth, right? Verse 26, how is it then, brethren, when ye come together, each one of you have a psalm, have a doctrine, have a tongue, have a revelation, have an interpretation. Let all things be done unto what? Edifying, meaning that people can understand you, right? Verse 27, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by chorus, and let one interpret it, okay? Meaning the unknown tongue in this six is in a different language from a different nationality or ethnicity, right? Verse 28, but if there be no interpreter, what? Let him keep silence in the church, and let him speak to himself and to the Most High, okay? Meaning this is not talking about some unknown tongue that no one knows about. This is speaking about if he speaks another language and no one in that church can understand what he's saying. So he's told to speak silent, right? He's told to stay silent, okay? Verse 28 again. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church and let him speak to himself and to the Most High. Verse 29. Let the prophets speak two or three, and let the other judge, all right? Meaning, like, if you're going to be speaking this word, like, if you out on the streets teaching and ministering onto the people, you got to have at least two or three, okay? Just as it's written in the law, just as it's written in the Gospels, okay? Just how the Most High operates. You have him, which is the Most High Power, and then you have Hamashiach, which is Christ, and then you have his Holy Spirit, okay? Three bear witness, all right? When two or three or amongst one another in the Holy Spirit teaching the word, then Hamashiach is amongst them in the Spirit, all right? And the Holy Spirit from the Most High, okay? So that's why it says this here, man. This Paul, he's just reiterating what's already written in the scriptures, right? Verse 29, again from the top. Let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge, man, right? Verse 30. If anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. Verse 31. For ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn, okay? Meaning, if you're prophesying in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, okay, it's going to be to where people can understand you, all right? They can interpret it, what you're saying, right? For ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted, okay? And the spirits of the prophets are subjugated to the prophets, okay? Just like I said, but it's written here, subject to the prophets, right? So, just like I said before, man, if you were a prophet in your past life, through the regeneration, you're going to be a prophet in this life, okay? They're going to be speaking the truth of this word. You're going to be ministering onto the people, man. Whether it's through these videos here, or if you're on the street, if you're passing out flyers or whatever, you're ministering on to the people. You know, even if you're on social media and, you know, you're having a dialogue with somebody, you know, about the scriptures, about the truth, you know what I'm saying? You're ministering on to people, man, right? You are an ordained prophet of the Most High because you are a lover of truth, all right? That's why it says this here, verse 32. And the spirits of the prophets are subjugated to the prophets, verse 33. For the Most High power is not the author of what? Confusion, okay? He's not the author of confusion, speaking in an unknown tongue, all right, that no one can understand, all right? For the Most High power is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints, meaning all of the bodies, all of the gatherings of the saints, right? The saints are basically the children of Israel, man. Okay, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, and Seminole Indians of Negro descent. Now, just to give this clear distinction here, this is talking about the people who's keeping the laws, statutes, the commandments of the Most High, the hopeful one-third elect, man. It's not talking about every single Israelite, all right? Because you do have a two-thirds out there. Those are your so-called Muhammad and Allah worshipers in Islam. Your so-called Virgin Hail Mary worshipers and religious churchianity and Roman Catholicism, okay? Your ancestral worship people, all right, in African spirituality. You know, the ones who dip and dive into witchcraft, all right? They're in these secret societies, fraternities, worshiping all of these multiple gods, man, these false idols of ancient Greco-Rome, okay? So you do have a two-thirds out there, man. All right, your Pan-Africanists, okay, your Salasai worshipers and Rastafarian doctrine and religion, all right. So not every Israelite is a saint, man, all right. It's clearly talking about the ones who's keeping the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High. All right, just to throw that in there, right. So in moving along, I digress. Let's go to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Okay, here we go in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and I'm just going to read verse 1, and it reads, "This is the third time I am coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word," okay, "every spoken uttered word be established," all right, just like I was bringing out in the book of 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, all right, and in the 14th chapter, all right, you have to have two or three people amongst one another in the spirit of the Most High, okay, for it to be established in truth according to the biblical scripture, man, right? So if you're speaking in an unknown tongue and no one can understand what you're saying, then that can't be established. There's no truth in that because no one don't understand or know what you're saying, okay? Let's go to the book of Thessalonians chapter 2. So it's all throughout the scriptures, man. And this is a majority of the New Testament that I'm reading here. So if you're a so-called Christian, a churchgoer, then you should know this right here. You should know if you're speaking in tongues, it have to be in a language where people can understand you, man, right? So here we go. We're in the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 2. And I'm going to start at verse 1, and it reads, "For yourselves, brethren, know our entrance in unto you, that it was not in vain," okay, verse 2, "but even after that we had suffered therefore, and were shamefully entreated, as ye know, at Philippi, we were bold in our God, which is our power, to speak unto you the gospel of the Most High power with much contention." All right. Verse 3. "For our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of uncleanness, nor in guile," meaning there was no deceit. They spoke the truth according to the biblical scripture, man, right? "But as we were allowed of the Most High power to be put in trust with the gospel," meaning that the Most High is only going to trust those who love truth, the ones who's keeping his laws, statutes, commandments, man. We are the people who the Most High trusts to spread his gospel, man, in truth, faith, and sincerity, man, right? Verse 4 again from the top. "But as we were allowed of the Most High power to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but the Most High power, which trieth our hearts," which is our minds, man, meaning he's going to see if we're really about this life, man, right? If we're sincere about keeping his laws, statutes, commandments, and spreading his truth without guile, without deceit, being a light bearer, all right? Verse 5. "For neither at the time use we flattering words, as ye know, nor a cloak of covetousness. The Most High is witness," okay? Meaning that we didn't try to flatter you. We didn't try to entice you and use all of these big flattering titles to call people, you know, to invite them in to hear what we have to say. You know, we wasn't about that. We came with all truth and nothing but truth, right? Verse 6. "Nor of men sought we glory, neither of you, nor yet of others, when we might have been burdensome as the apostles of Hamashiach," meaning that you was burdensome, or we are burdensome to the people who truly don't believe in Hamashiach. They believe in the image of the beast and religious churchianity, all right? They believe in Hail Mary and Roman Catholicism, right? So we're burdensome to these people. We burdensome to people who believe in Allah and Muhammad, Krishna, Shiva, and Madhava in Hinduism. They believe in their Buddha statue, their witchcraft, okay? Their African ancestry, okay? Practicing necromancy, which is against the law, okay? So we're burdensome to guys like that, right? Verse 7. "But we were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherish her children." Verse 8. "So being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of the Most High only, but also our own souls, because ye were dear unto us." Verse 9. "For ye remember, brethren, our labor in travail." Okay, so this is why I'm doing this video, man, so it can be remembered. This is my labor to our people, man, to wake our people up out of this spiritual stupor, right? Especially the ones who claim to be Christians, that when you're speaking in tongues, you're speaking in a known tongue, you're speaking the truth of the Most High, man, according to the oracle of his scriptures, according to his word, man. I'm letting you know that the laws are still here, okay? The Most High is not a changing God, okay? The commandments are still here to stay until he send Hamashiach back, okay? This is the voice of reason and truth to our people, man, all right? For repentance, to get them to turn back to their power, okay? You don't have to turn back to Allah and Muhammad, okay? Krishna, Shiva, and Madhava and Hinduism, worshiping your ancestors and African spirituality. They've been dead for numerous of years, man. They gone. They don't even know who you are, all right? According to the book of Ecclesiastes, you know, when people die, their love, their hate, you know, their jealousy, their envy, their want, their covetousness, all of that, it perish away with them, man. So they don't have no thoughts of this life. They don't even know who you are, but you call yourself trying to worship them and summon them up and call them back to direct you in your life, okay? They already lived their lives, man. They're gone. They're waiting for judgment of the Most High, okay? So you can't summon them up and tell them to direct you and direct your footsteps in your life to tell you where you should go, all right? You have your own life to live, man, right? And then you shall be inquiring to the Most High through Hamashiach, your steps to take, right? But as it's written in the Gospels, it says, seek ye the kingdom first, and then all else shall be added on to you. So first, really, you should be doing the work of the Most High if you consider yourself a so-called Christian and a believer in this scripture, man. If you're of the 12 tribes of Israel, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, the Seminole Indians of Negro descent, man, right? Verse 9, again from the top. For ye remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day. Okay, this is what I'm doing, man. Laboring night and day. Making these videos, man. If I'm not making a video, I'm on social media. Ministering and spreading the word. If I'm not doing that, during my errands and out and about routines, I'm passing out flyers, man. Alright? Because we would not be chargeable onto any of you. We preached unto you the gospel of the Most High power. Okay, so this is what we do, man. Every single day, man, right? Without rest. You know, the devils ain't going to rest. Your enemies and your oppressors is not going to rest. So we're not going to rest, right? We're going to continue to push this truth, man. This is a spiritual battle that's going on right now, man. All right, so we always going to push this truth no matter what. No matter if it's out and about in the world or if it's on the internet, social media, what have you, right? This is what we have to do as true servers and believers and men of the Most High God of the Bible, man, right? So in continuation, let's go to the book of 2nd Esdras, which is in the book of Apocrypha, chapter 14. Okay, so here we go. We're in the book of 2nd Esdras, chapter 14. And I'm going to go down to verse 38. And it reads, and the next day, behold, a voice calling me, saying, Esdras, open thy mouth and drink that I give thee to drink. Then opened I my mouth, and behold, he reached me a full cup, which was full as it were with water. Okay, what's the water? The truth of these scriptures, man. The doctrine, the wisdom, okay? The oracles of the Most High power, right? But the color of it was like fire, all right? Verse 40. And I took it and drank. And when I had drunk of it, my heart uttered understanding, okay? Uttered understanding, all right? Not an unknown tongue, okay? And wisdom grew in my breast, right? Meaning my spirit, you know, my soul. For my spirit strengthened my memory, okay? So this right here, this truth is going to bring strength to your memory, man, all right? Even for all of you people with Alzheimer's or short-term memory. That's not like a laughing matter, but you can actually relate this to this, man. You know what I'm saying? If you're dealing with truth according to the Most High, according to these scriptures, man, the Holy Spirit will heal you, man, okay? Our God, our power is a healer, man, of the sick, all right? Whether it be physically, mentally, or spiritually, mainly spiritually, because when you heal yourself spiritually, then all else will follow, man, okay? You're going to be healed physically and mentally when you're first healed spiritually, man, all right? Verse 40, again from the top. And I took it and drank. And when I had drunk of it, my heart uttered understanding, and wisdom grew in my breast. For my spirit strengthened my memory. Okay, my spirit strengthened my memory. It didn't say no medicine. Okay, it didn't say some sort of a tonic. All right, some sort of a pharmaceutical tonic or whatever. It said my spirit strengthened my memory, man. Right? Verse 41. And my mouth was open and shut no more. Okay, so this is what happened to us, man. When the Most High gave us that cup to drink, man, which is of wisdom. All right. Our mouths isn't shut no more, man. We're going to push this word whenever we get the chance, man. Whenever the Most High allow us to, through the Spirit. All right. This is what we're going to do, man. All right. We're going to be the whistleblowers. Okay. We're going to be the trumpet blowers. Right. The watchmen. All right. This is what we're going to do, man. We're going to sow the seeds. We're going to be the ambassadors for the kingdom, man. The heirs to the kingdom for our people, man, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, and Seminole Indians of Negro descent. First to our people and then to the rest of the world, man. Because when it's all said and done, everyone in the world should be keeping the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High. But first, starting with our people, man. Right? Verse 41, again, from the top. And my mouth was open and shut no more. Okay? Let's go to verse 43. As for me, I spake in the day and I held not my tongue by night. Okay, so we always going to push this word, man. Let's go down to verse 45. And it came to pass when the 40 days was fulfilled that the highest spake, saying, the first that thou hast written, publish openly, that the worthy and the unworthy may read it. Okay, meaning the children of Israel, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, Seminole Indians of Negro descent, and the unworthy, okay, which is the people of the other nations, the ones who the laws, statutes, commandments, and the oracles, and the ordinances, okay, and the judgments, and the promises wasn't given to, okay, also the covenant, all right? So that's why it says this here, man, verse 45, again, from the top. And it came to pass when the 40 days, all right, remember that number, 40, okay, that number is very significant in the scriptures, man, right, were fulfilled, that the highest spake, saying, the first that thou hast written, publish openly. This is him telling this to Esther, right, that the worthy and the unworthy may read it. Verse 46, but keep the 70 last, that thou mayest deliver them only to such as be wise among the people. Who's the wise among the people? That's the ones that's keeping the law, statutes, the commandments of the Most High. The ones who have the living water, man. Okay, the truth. The ones who's ministering to our people, repentance, man. Okay? So, of course, you're going to have the 70, which is the milk. And then you're going to have the last, which is the meat. The understanding, right? The true understanding, the prophecies, the secrets, right? In continuation, verse 47, for in them is the spring, okay? Now, what's associated with the spring? The water, the water springing up, right? Out of the spring, right? From the earth, the groundwater, okay? From the pressure of the earth, right? For in them is the spring of understanding, the fountain of wisdom, okay? The water fountain of wisdom and the stream, okay, which is water again, of knowledge, all right? What's the water? Again, it's the scriptures, the truth, man, all right? And I did so, okay? So let's go to the book of Zephaniah, chapter 3, and I'm going to end it there. Okay, so here we go. In closing, we're in the book of Zephaniah, chapter 3, and I'm going to go down to verse 9, and it reads, For then will I turn to the people a pure language, okay, that they may call upon the name of the Most High Power to serve him with one consent, okay? Let's jump down to verse 12. I will also leave in the midst of thee an afflicted and poor people, and they shall trust in the name, okay, the true name of the Most High Power, all right? Not the ones that's given to you from religious churchianity, the image of the beast, or Greco-Roman Catholicism, all right, and who worship Hail Mary, which is known as Virgin Mary. There's nowhere in the scriptures that tells our people, which is the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, Native Americans, Seminole Indians, to worship Virgin Mary, man. Okay, you're supposed to give honorship to Christ, the spiritual son of the Most High, man, right? Verse 12 again from the top. I will also leave in the midst of thee an afflicted and poor people, and they shall trust in the name of the Most High Power, which is that hopeful one-third elect, man, right? Verse 13. The remnant, okay, the remnant, the hopeful one-third, all right, of Israel shall do no iniquity. What is iniquity? Sin. What is sin? The transgression of the Most High's laws, statutes, and commandments, right? The remnant of Israel shall do no iniquity nor speak lies. Okay, so we're not going to tell you that we're speaking to the Most High if we're speaking in an unknown tongue and dancing around like some buffoon or something like that, right? Neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth. Okay, so we're going to be speaking the truth of these words, man, of these scriptures, the oracles of the Most High, man. We're going to be ministering onto our people truth and repentance, man, all right? Neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth, for they shall feed and lie down, and none shall make them afraid, okay? Meaning the other nations, man, right? Even the sinners of our people, the two-thirds, man, the sinners, okay? The ones who don't believe in these scriptures, man. The Most High is going to have his angels protect us, man. So no one's going to make us afraid. We're going to be protected as long as we stay doing what we're supposed to do according to the word of the Most High. We're not going to be afraid, man. Okay? This, as it's written in the book of Proverbs, you know, the angels encampeth around them that feareth the Lord, man. If you're fearing the Most High, you're keeping his laws, statutes, and commandments and spreading his word, man. All right? For they shall be fed and lie down, and none, okay, shall make them afraid. All right? So I'm going to end this here. And just like I said, this is to bring clarity to what speaking in tongues and operating through the Holy Spirit means according to the biblical scripture, man, right? So hopefully that this video was enjoyable. Hopefully that it was edifying. Until the next time, this is your brother once again, Yahawada Yasharah from the Sea Souls of Israel, the Rocks of Offense, and also the Ambassadors for Righteousness, the Restorers of Paths, and the Repairers of the Breach. Dropping you another informative video.